Our second speaker is Sri Ekta. I actually know Sri for many years. We were colleagues together back in the late 90s in the economics department of the And I also knew of Sri's work in labor economics and econometrics. We explored that in my doctoral thesis. I used many methods of data analysis that Sri was instrumental in creating. Not only is Sri a very well-known labor economist and econometrician, he's also a very well-accomplished monetary economist. In fact, he was the deputy governor of the Bank of Israel, second in command of the bank to the current governor of Stanford Israel. Sri is also a former editor of the European Economic Review, a current fellow of the Econometric Society. And now he's been recently appointed as the dean of the School of Economics at ITC. So not only does Sri do all these things, he also does research in the economic history of the Jews. In fact, he has a forthcoming book on the subject being published by Princeton University Press, and that is the topic of tonight's podcast. So he's going to give us a short, brief overview of his new book, which will be very well received. So go to it.
Thank you. That's the common option. Well, we try to think about, is there a common factor behind the truth in the history of that period that was unique for the Jews, and it was different from the rest of the population, because they had this kind of very significant Friedman practice. And we claim, and that's what I'm going to tell you, we're going to give you some facts, which we collected for 30 years, is the shift in the religion, known of Judaism, after the destruction of the temple, which basically sacrifices in the temple, which operated very much like a pagan society, could not be continued as the temple destroyed, was replaced by one owner that occupied the Jews from that period to today, is learn. Teach your son to read the Torah. Teach your son to read the Torah in Hebrew. Be literate. And learning is the key goal of the Jewish religion from the time when they established the Sanhedrin in Yavne, they moved to Sepphoris and from there to Tiberias. And from there they also lived in Mesopotamia, become the center of the religion. Why? Jews had many groups within Judaism, but they were all monotheistic before the destruction of the temple. They had the Sadducees, who were the group who wrote the temple. They had the Pharisees, who were the teachers, and Hillel, Shammai. They had the Essenes, who lived in the desert. They had the Zealots. Like all religions today, they had different types of groups. But the Pharisees stressed education. They emphasized that education of the Torah is the center of Judaism. And when the Pharisees become the high priest, Yeshua the Gamla, he made an order that all Jewish fathers to teach their sons to read. That did not be implemented immediately. When the temple destroyed, then sacrifices in place to study the Torah. And then the leadership of the rabbis who established what is called the Mishnah. The Mishnah is a six books which written to fathers, emphasize their reading, and actually implement the rule that who does not learn to read and who does not teach his son to read is actually Am HaAretz and is a knockdown on Jews and cannot be testified in Jewish court, and his living was viewed as a and then basically, for fathers, they established synagogues. Well, synagogues at that time was a place to learn to read the Torah, not the place as today. And the synagogues which existed before become the center of Judaism. And the question is, what would happen to a religion of fathers who don't gain from learning and becoming better fathers, if they have to invest a lot in teachers, a term that we read a lot in the Talmud, a term that says that we have to pay the teachers, a term that says that teaching the sons to read the Torah is a community obligation, that all the sons, the orphans, and the poor, and all of them have to learn. It becomes a huge expense, because books at that time were extremely expensive. Teachers require lots of payment. And what happened is that economic theory tells us that if you put a large amount of money into learning that does not involve your productivity, some people may choose not to be Jews, or to be new Jews, who were at the second, third century the new Jews, the Christians, who accepted the Torah, but did not implement the reading as a requirement. And therefore, it was more attractive finding about 500,000 Jews lost their lives. And then there was a rebellion against the Roman religion, about 300,000 Jews lost their lives. Then in the 135, the October rebellion, maybe another 500,000 lost their lives. But there is about 2 million people left Judaism between 200 to 632. And when we see the data, we provide evidence that basically there is a strong evidence that Jews who were illiterate basically moved to Christianity. Where they moved, the areas of a lot of Christians basically had a lot of Jews in the neighborhood. So basically, it is the chosen people. Those who invest in education, those who invest in synagogue, those who invest in learning the Torah, stay Jews. Those who learn become the source of Christianity. But what we learn is that once you teach your sons to read, and we have evidence on the Talmud that they actually implement it, then the Jews have an economic comparative advantage. As we count it many years later, in being in occupation where literacy and reading has a comparative advantage, where the demand for this occupation was low, they move into this occupation very low, very slow. But a big change in the ancient world happened when the Muslim Empire was established in the 7th century. And in the 8th century, 90% of the Jews live in the Sultanate, in Babylon. Almost all the Jews who from Eretz Israel either become Christians or move to Babylon. And at that time, just in Babylon, where the Jews live in villages and in towns, the Muslims established Baghdad in 758. And Baghdad immediately became the center of a big empire that connected all the way from Spain to China. And the Jews, in 150 years, documented very clearly, moved from the villages to the cities. Why? Only the Jews, all of them, moved into the towns. Other women as well. But why all the Jews move into urban occupations? Because the Jews had a comparative advantage in reading. Why would reading Hebrew give you a comparative advantage? Two reasons. Already the Jews established the Talmud and the yeshiva and the law with rabbis and leaders and judges that can deal with any economic and personal dispute and any contract that can start. Second, they can write between them contracts. So if you're a merchant and you go and bring a new piece of leather from India to Baghdad, you can write a contract on the price and you can write down from there what's the price. And we have evidence of this leather. is in order to bring the ability to be merchants and to provide better merchandise and to provide better economic relationship. And we have quotes to say by the Pope, where one king complained about the name of the Jews to come, where he says, it's true, they killed Jesus, but they bring economic success. And therefore, they got the privileges existing in all Christian Europe. It's founded by Charles the Great, the son of the grandson of Charles the Great in the 9th century, but it's continued all the way to the 13th century. The Jews move into England under privileges and they all become moneylenders. Moneylending is just a more complicated financial complex activity that required capital, required protection of the king, and also provide a lot of income with a lot of risk to the providers of this moneylending. So basically, what we have is a movement into occupations where the Jews could use the literacy, where the society around was maybe illiterate, and in this way, basically supporting a very relatively expensive religion. Why it's expensive? Because they invested more in education. We have evidence, the key evidence that I want to share with you is the Gnisa. I don't know if you've heard about the Gnisa, but the Gnisa is a place in the synagogue that existed for most synagogues where the Jews throw in pieces of paper written, because in Jewish religion, every written document is sacred. You're not supposed to destroy it. Not too many Gnisas exist, but in Cairo, in Postate, the old Cairo, in the late 19th century, they found one room where documents from the 9th century till the 19th century were survived. And those documents were collected by a professor from Cambridge, and they all documented, and you can see them on the internet today. Those documents, almost all of them, are written in Hebrew scribes. What language? They wrote in Hebrew, the language they spoke. What language they spoke from the 9th century to the 19th century in Fuste, next to what is Cairo, the old Cairo, Arabic. So in order to understand it, you have to know Arabic, and you have to know Hebrew, and you have to know Arabic at all time in order to understand all time. What the document tells us is all in 12 volumes by Professor Boyden, making a great story, who described the life of the Mediterranean Jewish and non-Jewish society. And his first dissertation book is about what? their income where they look for opportunities worldwide. In the Pisa, there is a story about Benishma, a young guy, a son of a rabbi from Los Angeles, who decided he wanted to make money. And he knew the center of Judaism at that time, in the 11th century, is Cairo. So he goes to Cairo. And he asks his friends, where are you going to make money? They say, to Amman. In Yemen, on the Indian Ocean. And when he went there, the Jewish Nagid at the time, today Nagid is the governor of the Bank of Israel, at that time Nagid was the leader of the community. A large merchant, the Cuban world community, he told them, if you want to make money, you go to India. And he goes to India, and very soon he becomes very. Then he comes back. He had an Indian wife, he had permission from the rabbi in Cairo to bury an Indian servant. He had kids, and he came back to them and to Egypt later on. One more story about Jewish life at that time. Did the Jews become moneylenders because they choose to be moneylenders, or because they forced to be moneylenders? Jews in England came to England in 1060 when William the Conqueror used them as the financiers of the moving into England. They established in England 3,000 families, all working in money lending, all over England. Where they were forced, when they tried to be forced with the people who they lent to them, the upper class families, try to burn their contracts and try to convert them in York. At the end of the 12th century, they have decided to jump off the tower rather than to convert or to move to another occupation. In 1290, the king of England decided to replace the Jews' moneylenders with the Lombards. And he offered them to be any occupation by moneylenders. Why with the Lombards? Because he had a better deal with the Lombards. Every deal the Jews kept as moneylenders, they had to pay taxes. And the Lombards were willing to pay higher taxes than the Jews at that time. He wanted to replace them. They decided all to leave England. And actually, they left England in 1290, and they came back probably almost 300 years later. And last, and not least, is the story of the Mongols. In 1220, still 70% of the Jews live in what is today Iran and Iraq. About 800,000 to 1 million Jews live in what we call the Mesopotamia, or Iraq and Iran. In 1220, Genghis Khan entered the Iran. He destroyed the economy. He destroyed the Jewish community. In 1258, he came to Baghdad. He destroyed Baghdad and killed many people. And he killed the Jews as well. The whole area, economically, was completely devastated, and probably even today not kind of came back to where it was in 1258. Baghdad in 1258 was a city of 1 million, as big as Constantinople, with about 200,000 Jews living there. 300 years later, Baghdad was a city of maybe 50,000 people, with very few Jews living. And basically, the whole Jewish community shrank there from around 800,000 to maybe 200,000 within 300 years. Because